pornography, you want to learn how to get over lying, you want to learn how to get over stealing, you want to learn how to get over gossiping, you have to learn how to fast. Because fasting breaks the power of the flesh over your life. It breaks the power of the flesh over your mind. Depression, contrary thoughts and contrary thinking. Fasting breaks the power over the of the flesh over your life. If you're not going to fast, then you're not going to get the victory over what's plaguing you.
Amen.
If you're not willing to fast, then you're not going to overcome that lust. You're not going to overcome that flesh. You're not going to overcome that desire, because the only way you're going to break that is you're going to have to learn how to fast. And when you learn how to fast, you break the power of your will and your flesh over your life, and you render it inoperable. Right. It's like taking a plug out of the wall. You pull the plug out, the fan stops, because the plug gives it power. Your flesh is empowered by food. Your flesh is empowered by food. The food, it strengthens your flesh. It strengthens the will of your flesh. It bogs your spirit down. It bogs it down. Especially if you eat a lot of meat. It bogs your spirit down. It puts your spirit in a position where it's weighed down. That's the reason why people say, when I eat a heavy meal, I feel like going to sleep. You get tired, because food has that effect on the flesh.
Amen.
It bogs you, it weighs you down. So Jesus tells them here, he says, listen, if you want to get the victory, he says, you're going to have to learn how to deny yourself food. When you deny yourself food, he says, what's going to happen is, it's going to allow the Spirit of God that is inside of you now to come to the forefront.
Amen.
Okay, the Spirit of God that's been weighed down and pressed down, he says, now, because you have humbled yourself, because you have now made your flesh your enemy, he says, now the Spirit of God is going to come to the forefront, and now you're going to be more sensitive to the things of God. You can pray better now. You can hear God better now. You can sense the presence of God now, because you got your flesh out of the way. You got your will out of the way. You can't do that when your flesh is high, when your flesh is strong, when your flesh is in control. It's hard to pray. It's hard to seek God, because as soon as you get down on your knees, as soon as you start to pray, all kind of stuff start going through your mind. I want to get up and do this and do that and all this kind of stuff, because your flesh is not broken yet. But when you learn how to pray, see, when you learn how to pray, when you learn how to lay before God, you're going to lay on that floor, and you'll start feeling it in your flesh. You start getting aggravated and roll over on one side and roll over on the other side, and you get up on your knee. You start doing all kind of stuff. You know what that is? That's the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
That's the flesh being humbled. That's the flesh being broke. All of that is a part of prayer. All of that is a part of prayer. All of that is a part of prayer. The Bible says that when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, he prayed, and blood started coming out of his face. Blood came out of his sweat. Blood was mixed with his sweat, because all the agony, prayer is not comfortable to the flesh. Prayer doesn't feel good to the flesh. The flesh doesn't like to pray. That's why you have to learn how to stay there, even when it becomes uncomfortable. Even when you feel like getting up. Even when you feel like going and doing something else. You have to learn how to stay there, because that's a part of prayer. It is the breaking of my flesh. It is the breaking of my will. It is the breaking. That's why the old church used to make us come to the altar and cry out, Jesus, Jesus. Because in the process of crying out, Jesus, Jesus, our flesh was broken. Our will was broken. We forgot about everybody that was around. We forgot about everything that was going on. We forgot about what we was wearing and who was looking at us, and we focused on him. Our flesh was broken at the altar, and that's when we were able to tap into him. Because when you submit yourself to God, the Bible says submit yourself to God. When you submit yourself to God, God gives grace to the humble.
Yes.
The Bible says he gives grace to those who are willing to humble themselves, but to the proud, God says, I will resist them. See, the altar is very important. We got to bring the altar back to our lives.
Yeah.
We got to bring the altar back to our lives. See, ain't no use you coming to the altar at the church if you don't have an altar at your home.
Amen.
You're fooling yourself.
Amen.
If you're going to have an altar, if you're going to build an altar, the first place you build an altar is at your house. The first place you build an altar is at your home. Because if you ain't praying at home, you ain't going to pray here. If you're not praying at home, you're not going to pray on your job. So the first place you're going to get your wood and build an altar is at your house.
Amen.
Find you a place. Designate that place. This is the place where I commune with God. This is the place where I fellowship with God. This is the place where I bear my heart, bear my soul before God. This is the place where I open myself up before God. This is my place of meeting. This is my place of communion. All through the scripture, God told the people, he told them to mark the places where you and I talk. Make a memorial here. Put some stones here. Make something here that people will know that this is the place I met you, that this is the place that you and I commune together. Yes. You and I talk and walk together here. This is the place where you got your prayers answered, where you got your children healed, where you got your marriage fixed. He says, make a memorial here that this is our place of meeting. Make prayer a priority in your life. So we have to connect fasting with prayer. I just told you why we do it. Fasting breaks my flesh. It gets my will out of the way. It humbles me before God. It humbles me because when we deny food, the flesh starts to talk to us. The flesh starts to talk to us, start to tell us, well, I don't like this. I don't like this. I want this. I want that. But we have to ignore that. You're not starving. You're not dying. That's just the flesh talk. That's just the flesh saying, I want this. I want that. And that's the very thing that we have to control. That's the thing that we have to get the victory over. We have to get the victory over those desires, those feelings, those impulses. We have to get those things and bring them subject to Christ. Because if we don't take control over them, then they're going to take control over us.
Amen.
All right. Let's go to the book of Luke, the 11th chapter. There are some things in your life, Christian, that will not happen until you learn how to pray. Until you learn how to pray and fast, there are some things in your life that you can see, but you will never see it manifest. When I say see, I'm talking about you know it belongs to you. That's a part of you that you can see yourself doing it. You can visualize it, how nice it would be to have it, but you will never see it manifest until you learn how to pray and fast. There are some walls in your life that will not come down until you learn how to pray and fast. There are some barriers that you will not overcome until you learn how to connect fasting and prayer together. When you learn how to pray and fast, then those walls, those barriers will begin to fall down. You'll begin to see victories that you've never seen before. But until you learn how to do that work, you will not see the reward, because it's going to take that to get the deliverance.
Yes.
There are some things that you have to drive your enemy out. He ain't going to just give it to you. You have to drive him out. You want to push him out. You have to force him out. This belongs to me. Okay. I told you to go to Luke, the 11th chapter, right?
Yes, sir.
All right, the principle that I'm teaching you right now is called commit to the fight. You're taking notes, write that down. I'm going to give you some scripture to connect with that. Talk about prayer and fasting. And connect with prayer and fasting. I want you to understand this principle. Commit to the fight. Okay, verse number 1 from Luke, the 11th chapter. It says, and it came to pass that as he was praying in a certain place, talking about Jesus, when he ceased, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. And he said unto them, when you pray, okay, drop down to Luke 11 chapter, verse number 5. It says, and he said unto them, which of you shall have a friend, and he shall go unto him at midnight and say unto him, friend, lend us 3 loaves. For a friend of mine in his journey has come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. And he shall from within shall answer and say, trouble me not, the door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give thee. Verse number 8, I say unto you, though he would not rise and give him because he is his friend, yet because of his importunity, that word is very important, importunity, he will rise and give him as much as he is needed, as many as he needed. Now, when you go to verse number one talks about the disciples asking Christ, say, Lord, teach us how to pray. They was watching Jesus pray. They watched him pray. Once he got finished praying, verse number 1 says they came to him and said, Lord, teach us how to pray. We see that you're a man of prayer. We see that you pray and communicate to the Father. We see that God works through you because of your prayer life. He says, we need you to teach us how to pray the same way John taught his disciples how to pray. So Jesus, in verse number 2 all the way down to verse number 11, begins to talk to them about how to pray. how to pray. He tells them, he says, listen to this. He says, when you pray, he says, matter of fact, he says this. He says, listen, I'm giving you a scenario. He says, there was a man who had a friend, and his friend came to him in need and needed some stuff that he couldn't give him. He didn't have the supplies that he needed. But he said, but he had someone that he knew that could meet this need. So the Bible says at midnight, he went to his house and knocked on his door. And the man said, listen, I'm in the bed with my family. We are all asleep. Go somewhere else. I can't help you. But the Bible says that he kept on knocking at the door. And the Bible says that because of his importunity. What is importunity? Importunity is that he was unwilling to quit. Importunity, he was not willing to give up. He was bold. He was brash. He was unrestrained. He refused to not be heard. He refused to not get what he needed. He knew that the friend had the supplies. When you read the scripture, it shows you that he knew that the friend had the supplies. And he knew that if he continued to knock, his friend was going to open the door. He said, I'm not going to stop. Importunity is the mindset of I refuse to stop. Keep knocking. I'm going to keep asking. I'm going to keep praying. I'm going to keep praising. I'm going to keep thanking until what I'm praying for, asking for, and thanking him for shows up in my life. I'm not going to stop. I'm not going to get quiet. I'm not going to slow down. I'm going to keep up the intensity. I'm going to keep the fervency. I'm going to keep the fire. I'm going to aggravate him. I'm going to frustrate him. I'm going to bother him until he answers me.
Amen.
There's a scripture in the Old Testament. It says to those, it talks to the intercessor. It says, ye remembrances of God. He says, keep not quiet until God answers you.
Amen.
He said, y'all who have been called to remind God, you intercessors, he says, do not be quiet.
Mm-hmm.
He said, don't be silent until God shows up. When he shows up, then you can stop. But until God shows up, he says, do not keep quiet.
Yes.
Until the girls come home, you stay on your knees.
Yes, God.
Okay, I gotta show you this. Let's go to the book of Acts. Let's go to the book of Acts. Let me see, can I find this? Somebody say, commit to the fight.
Commit to the fight.
You gotta commit to the fight. If you're wishy-washy, you ain't gonna win. If you wishy-washy, you are not gonna be victorious in prayer. You gotta commit to the fight. You gotta lock in on what it is you're praying for. You got to lock in. If you praying for healing in your body, you got to lock in and you can't let go. You can't get weary. You can't back up. You gotta lock in on that thing and you don't let go until you see the manifestation. You don't pull back. You lock in and you push until what is you're praying for manifests.
Amen.
You gotta commit to the fight. You can't win the fight if you got one foot in the fight. No, you gotta commit all the way to the battle. All the way. I'm all the way in. The Bible says many times in dealing with pride that they will set their face to seek the Lord. They will set their heart to seek the Lord. What does that mean? It means that they made a decision. I'm gonna seek God. I'm going to pray about this until this thing changes. When I set my face, when I set my mind, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to do this. I'm going to accomplish this. I'm not going to back up. I'm not going to give in. I'm not going to stop crying until God. That's what the Bible talks about in the book of Luke. He said what made this man effective was that he kept on knocking.
Yes.
Lord.
He kept on hitting the door.
Yes.
Now somebody would have knocked a couple of times and went home. But this man said, I'm not going to stop knocking until you answer this door because I know you.
Amen.
I know you a healer. I know you a healer. How do you know he's a healer? Because his word tells me that inside of him is my healing.
Yes, God.
You showed me you a healer.
Thank you.
You showed me you are a deliverer. What scripture the Bible says, the Lord is my salvation. Whom shall I fear? He is my salvation. What I need is right on the other side of this door. I'm not going to stop knocking.
Amen.
I'm not going to stop knocking. I'm not going to knock quiet. I'm going to knock hard. I'm going to knock vigorously. I'm going to knock continuously until he opens this door, because what I need is right on the other side of this door. In the book of Acts, when Peter was locked up in jail, where is that at?
It's 12:5 maybe.
Okay, verse number 5, Acts 12, thank you. Talk about commit to the fight. Bible says that while Peter was preaching, they took him captive, took him and locked him up in jail. Listen to what the Bible says, verse number 5. Peter therefore was kept in prison, but cry was made without ceasing. Say without ceasing.
Without ceasing.
That means they didn't stop praying. That means they started praying, and once they locked in the prayer, they said, we're not going to stop praying until this issue changes. They didn't say we're going to pray for 30 minutes. They didn't say I'm going to pray for an hour. No, they said we're going to pray about this until it changes. Say commit to the fight.
Commit to
You got to learn how to commit to the fight. You got to learn that that sickness is trying to kill you. You got to learn that the enemy is trying to destroy your child. You got to learn that the enemy is trying to destroy your marriage. This is not a time to fight on one day and then don't fight for another 3 days. You got to commit to the fight. When you start the battle, you got to fight every day. You got to set time. I'm going to meet you right here every day. We're going to fight right here every day. We're going to fight right here every day until I see the breakthrough. I'm going to commit to the fight, and I'm going to stay here as long as it takes.
Yes, God.
I'm not walking away from this. It's my marriage. It's my health. It's my children. It's my ministry. I can't walk away from this. I can't fight on Sunday and then don't fight again till next Sunday. You're going to lose. You can't pray on Monday and then don't pray again for 3 days. You're going to lose. You got to commit to the fight. You got to be all the way in. The Bible says that they pray without ceasing. This man was locked into a prison, a physical jail. The Bible says that they began, but prayer was made, but prayer, I love that, but prayer. They put him in prison, but prayer
what?
Was made without ceasing of the church. I mean, all the church began to pray for Peter unto God for him. And when Herod would have brought him forth, the same night Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and the keepers before the door kept the prison. And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison, and he smote Peter on the side and raised him up and said, arise up quickly, and his chains fell off from his hands. And the angel said unto him, gird thyself and bind on your saddles, put on your shoes. And so he did, and he said unto him, cast thy garment about thee and follow me. The angel said, get up, Peter, it's time to go.
Yes.
Somebody praying for you.
Amen.
These physical chains can't hold you because the church prayed.
Amen.
The prison doors can't hold you, Peter, because the church prayed. The guards can't keep you in here, Peter, because the church prayed. There's power in the church.
Yes.
There's power in the church. Bible says in the book of James that Elijah was a man just like you and me. But he prayed earnestly and God shut up the heavens. Bible says then he prayed earnestly again and God opened up the heavens and sent rain. He said the Bible makes a distinct effort to let you know that he was a man just like you and me. He was a human just like us. That's what the Bible said. He ain't no different than what we were or what we are. And he had the power to shut up the heavens through prayer. And so the Bible is teaching us that you got the same power. You got the same authority. You got the same rights. You got the same privilege. But you got to learn how to commit to prayer. You got to learn how to commit to the fight. The Bible teaches us in the book of Elijah, when he was praying for the rain to come, the Bible says that he sent his servant to look and see what's it raining. And the Bible says he sent him seven times. Seven times. Seven times he sent the man.
Amen.
Each time he went and looked, there was Bible says when he came back and said there was nothing, Elijah went back to praying.